Hello, Mr. Niren here. Welcome to Total War 1942, a mod for Rome Total War and Rome Total War Barbarian Invasion. The only difference is that the naval battles, which are custom battle and historical battle only, they only work on Barbarian Invasion. But everything else should work with original as well. So this mod is not for Alexander. Okay, so I have modified this mod. So I had an older version. I was part of the team. I did the least work of the team members on this mod, of course. I mean, Saloth-Sar or Leonid made the map and some of the gameplay on the map and such. And Dagovax Sirrianus made the rest of the mod. So it was mostly Saloth-Sar and Dagovax Sirrianus that made this mod. I did, however, 202 quotes, I believe, and the descriptions of all the factions except the Spanish state. And I believe that I did some edits on the map too, to add new troops. But that's all stuff from 2019, I believe. What I have done now is that I have... The fact is that I've received a bunch of different alpha versions and beta versions since 2019, I believe, or 2018, and in January 2020 I received a version 2.0, even though it states 1.3.1, but it's an early version 2.0 without the text being changed, and that version added all the German custom cities except the Berlin capital, because it wasn't finished, and such this version had the German cities when I played it. I played a German campaign on my YouTube channel previously. I started it in January 2020, and it ended in a total defeat when Berlin fell, and I believe it, that was on December 23rd, but the video was uploaded on December 24th, on Christmas Eve. Okay. So, in that version I did some personal modifications, like giving tanks to everyone and planes to everyone and such, but not planes. I believe I gave tanks to everyone, but I believe some factions still lacked planes, like for example India. But in this version I have improved it more. So, Dagovax released the final 2.0 version in July or June this year, 2021, and then he released a 2.0.1 fix to it. But unfortunately that version, which added French custom cities and Italian custom cities and some other stuff, it added a new minor European campaign. That version unfortunately was unstable when playing the World War II campaign. 1942 campaign didn't work. You could play a few turns and then it would crash the desktop or CTD, and unfortunately when you started it up again it would happen at the same turn and place, so it was impossible to continue. And that's a shame, because that version had a bunch of additional new features that this version do not have. So I've spent a bit more than a week on adding everything that I could add from that version, except traits and triggers and religions and such, because I didn't want to mess with any such files, because I was afraid I would cause that crash to happen here as well. So in this version the game can crash, but whenever it does CTD or crash the desktop, you can easily just start it up and continue. It will work fine to just continue on the map. It will never happen at the same place and time, so you can finish a campaign in this version. And also the game can crash in battles, often in siege battles. Actually I've increased the numbers of units and troops, and when you play for example in a large city, a German custom settlement large city, then if you have too many troops on the battlefield it might crash, because too many numbers of units and a custom settlement, and you reach the hard-coded limit on polygons, I believe. That's why it's CTD. If the battles crash, you can start it up and play it again. That's why I advise in this mod, before when you install it, you need to patch the Rome Total War and Rome Total War Barbarian Invasion.exe files with the 4GB patch and the large address aware patch. That will enable the game to take advantage of 4GB of memory, of RAM memory, instead of just 2GB. So that patch is absolutely necessary. I'm not sure that you need both of them. They might be the exact same. But you need to patch the .exe files of the game with the 4GB patch or the large address aware patch, or do both. Otherwise you will probably crash all the time in this mod. Okay, and another thing is that when you start a game, if you play as, for example, the British Commonwealth of Nations, then when you before every battle, you need to save. So before you start any battle in real time, you should save the game. You can create a save. I suggest... Excuse me. So Rome Total War has an issue. Save games in both Medieval 2 Total War Kingdoms and in Rome Total War and its expansion packs, Barbarian Invasion and Alexander, they can get corrupted. So if you have only one save, for example, if you save Britain 1, and then you continue to overwrite that same save, then maybe on turn 4 or later, the save game might be corrupted and you can't load it, and then you have to restart everything. So I suggest to always have two saves. So if you play as Britain, make a save, name it whatever you want, but for easiness, let's just name it Britain 1 and Britain 2. And then whenever you're about to fight a battle in real time, then you overwrite the Britain 1 save, and then the next time you overwrite the Britain 2 save. So you always pick the one that hasn't been updated in a while, and by doing that, whenever one of the saves get corrupted, you can load the earlier one, so you don't have to restart from scratch. Also, you can still overwrite the corrupted save, then it will still work, because it's just corrupted on the turn that you saved. So if you overwrite that save later in the game, it will work again. But just be secure, you need two saves at all times, and overwrite the first save, and then the second save, and then the first save again, and then the second save, so that whenever a save file gets corrupted, you can go to the earlier one, and it won't be too much you have to replay, probably a battle. As I said, the battles can crash. Usually in this mod, they crash on siege battles when you have large numbers and fight in a custom settlement. And usually it happens like when you have killed 97% of the enemy and are about to win. This happens randomly, so it doesn't always happen. Sometimes you can play the battle just fine. But it happens too much. I believe in the version I played in 2020 it didn't, but I have increased the numbers. So for example, on huge size, in the version I played in 2020, a infantry regiment was at, I believe, 80 soldiers per regiment. But in this version I've maxed out the numbers, so they are 240 in a regiment. That's why I'm not playing on huge, I'm playing on large. But on large they are 120. That's still 40 more units in a unit than in the old version, where they were 80 on huge, and now they are 120 on large. So, and on normal they are 60, so that's 20 less than on old huge. And then on small they are 30. So it's increased by twice as much as the previous levels. So for example, if you have 30 on small, it will be 60 on normal, and then there will be 120 on large and 240 on huge. And then I have maxed out the planes and the tanks too, so instead of having like 10 or 12 tanks in a unit, you have now maybe 20 to 40 tanks, and planes, you have about 20 planes, 20 bikes, 20 cars, 20 trucks, etc. And yeah, it's very epic, and it usually won't crash in in the battlefield, but if you play a siege battle in a custom settlement, chances are it will crash in the late battle. And that's very annoying when you have almost won and then it's CTD. So I'm gonna play test now. And if there are too many CTD or crashes to desktop, I will most likely reduce the numbers back to how they were in the old version. I increased the numbers because I wanted an epic campaign with huge numbers of infantry, huge numbers of tanks, and huge numbers of planes. But if I think that if there is any if there are any, what should I say, if there is any truth to the game crashing more because of it, then I might return the numbers to how they were when I played the German campaign. It still crashed in maybe 3 or 4 battles, but that's better than it crashing in like every second battle. But we will see how often it will crash. So in the old version I played on very hard, I believe. I won't do that now. We will note battle time limit. And battle medium difficulty. Battle difficulty should be on medium, because anything above hard, anything above medium is just giving the enemy bonuses, and it's as strong as it is already. I mean, it's strong enough as it is. So in this game, we have a bunch of minor factions and some really strong superpowers or great powers. We have the great powers of World War II, and then we have some minor factions. And if you play a minor faction, you don't want to have it on very hard. And actually, I don't want that when I play a major faction either. So we will have the battle difficulty on medium, so that they won't get any bonuses. That's fair. And then medium difficulty in campaign. So I had very hard on, because that makes the enemy as aggressive on the map as it possibly can be. And also, I believe, on very hard they will be very aggressive and they will backstab you and a lot of stuff. You can't trust your allies, they will also stab you in the back. In the end, everyone will attack everyone, even their allies. Okay, there are a lot of revolts. I don't like revolts. There are some big problems with revolts on very hard. In certain areas, you take an area and exterminate it and place troops there, and still it revolts, and you have to retake it and retake it and retake it. So I prefer to play on an easier difficulty. You would think that medium would be fine, but actually I will choose and pick easy, because you will have almost no revolts on easy. And in Rome Total War, unlike in Medieval 2 Total War Kingdoms, first of all I feel like I'm an expert in Medieval 2, so I can play on very hard without problems and still win. But in Rome Total War I suck compared to in Medieval 2, so I need to play on medium or easy in Rome Total War, because the AI is much more intelligent in this game and more likely to win than in the other games, than in Medieval 2, I mean. And also, there are more revolts if you have anything from medium hard or very hard. So if you don't want revolts, I suggest using easy difficulty in the campaign. And in Rome Total War, unlike in Medieval 2, easy doesn't mean that they won't do anything. They are still aggressive and will attack you, but they are way less likely to stab an ally in the back if you play on easy. And they are less likely to revolt, and your enemy might not be as aggressive, but they are still aggressive. So I want to play on easy difficulty in the campaign with medium difficulty in battle. Now let's check the factions. So we have the British Commonwealth of Nations, also known as the British Empire. They are not just holding Britain here, they are holding the entire empire, including Canada in North America. They are holding Australia, they are holding New Zealand, they are holding some Ayers in the Pacific, including Singapore, and they are holding India, even though there are a few areas in India that have revolted and are independent under the Indian faction, but for the most part they hold half of India at least, and they hold areas in Africa. I believe they hold South Africa, and yeah, they hold Britain itself as well. Okay, so the British Commonwealth of Nations is also the British Empire. I believe the Commonwealth was the English-speaking areas, Canada, Britain, Australia, New Zealand, and then they had the provinces of the Empire, South Africa and India, and some other areas like Singapore. Okay, so they are playable. They are a great power, one of the strongest factions in the game. And by the way, in this version I ported all the new units from 2.0 to this version and all the new projectiles. So Britain has new tanks. In the previous version they had a Matilda light tank, an equivalent of the Panzer I. And then they had a Churchill heavy tank, an equivalent of the, I believe, German Tiger I, even though it's worse than the Tiger I, but it's their version of a heavy tank. And now they have gotten a medium tank, equivalent of the Panzer IV, the Cromwell tank, and they have also gotten a new elite tank. This game, by the way, starts in 1942, as the name suggests, Total War 1942, in the middle of World War II, when the Third Reich is at the height of its power. But the game has 24 turns per year. That means that each turn is half a month. So every turn you play half a month. Okay, and you can't end the game as early as 1945. So the game continues until 1954. That means you will reach the 50s and you will be fighting in an alternative history 50s. So that's why Britain has also gotten a 50s tank, the Centurion. That's their late game tank, equivalent of the German Maus that was only ever produced in two examples or prototypes. So there are some factions that have 50s stuff, 50s tanks in the late game, and there are some that have like futuristic stuff like the Maus. Okay, because the game starts in World War II and ends in the middle of the 50s, so that's why Dagovax added some stuff from the 50s as well to the factions for the late game. So Britain has two new tanks, a medium tank and a 50s tank, medium tank actually of the 50s, but it's still heavier than the heavy tank of the 40s. Okay. And then they have some new artillery units and stuff as well. Okay, then we have the United States of America, the USA. So I forgot to preview this faction when I started my German campaign in January 2020. But they are also playable. For some reason I never clicked on them. I checked every other faction, but not the United States. So the United States, they start in with 12 areas in North America. They are the single great power in North America. Of course, Britain is holding Canada, but they only have 3 regions, meaning they are like a small power in the region, but are a great power in the world stage. And the United States, they have 12 areas in this region. So they are the only great power in North America. But in the world, they are 1 out of 5 or so great powers. Okay, and there is no superpower. People commonly mistake great powers for superpowers, but there is a difference. During World War II, there were no superpowers, there were great powers. Germany was a great power, Britain was a great power, Japan was a great power, France, before their defeat, was a great power, and Soviet was a great power. And I believe also that Spain was a great power, but they didn't partake in the war. China, while having the numbers of a great power, wasn't a great power during World War II because they didn't have the industry and like tech technology to be counted as a great power. Okay, the only reason they survived Japan's invasion was because they got aid from the United States and Britain and others. Okay, but the point I'm making is that everyone in World War II were either small powers, minor powers, or great powers. There were no superpowers. After the war, two superpowers emerged, the United States of America and the Soviet Union. So they were the superpowers, and after the fall of Soviet in 1989, there were only one superpower remaining, the United States of America, while other powers like Britain, France, and Russia, etc., they are not superpowers, they are great powers. There is a difference between a great power and a superpower. A superpower is a power that dominates half of the world or more. Well, a great power is a regional power, like for example Germany in Europe is a great power in that area, but they do not have much power outside of Europe. Or for example Iran is a great power in their area, but have no power outside of that specific area. While the United States and Soviet, they divided the world between them after World War II. And after the fall of Soviet, the United States dominated the entire globe. Okay, so that's the difference between a great power and a superpower. And during World War II, we had only great powers and minor powers. And the United States is one of them. And besides the North America, they are holding Reykjavik, the capital of Iceland. They are holding some islands in the Pacific, bordering Japan. They are holding Casablanca in North Africa, Libya, or whatever, Tunisia or Libya, or Morocco. Actually, it might be Morocco where they start. And they are about to fight the Vichy French there, and the Nazis, and the Italians. Okay, so they have a bunch of areas outside of America, but mostly they have their forces in America. And they start without a fleet. They have a few ships, but most of their fleet has been sunk in the beginning of 1942. The attack on Pearl Harbor was in December 1941, so they have recently lost their fleet. Okay, we have the French Republic. They lost France, they are in Africa and in the Middle East. They want to reclaim France. Okay, we can see that the British Commonwealth, they have an easy campaign. Yeah, because they have probably most areas or territories in the world. And then the United States have a very easy campaign, yeah, because they are isolated from any other threat. But I have changed South America. We will take a look at that on the map later. I can say that South America is no longer League of Nations only. I've added three other factions there, so that the United States won't be entirely secure. But they still have the numerical advantage and the technological advantage over most of the enemies there. They always have the numbers. They have the technological advantage against everyone but Britain and one of the others. Okay, so we will check the French here. They start in Africa and in the Middle East. As I said, their campaign is hard because they start in underdeveloped areas and have lost all their cities in France. Okay. They are the Free French, so they are not the state of France. They are the people of France still fighting the Germans and such. Okay, we have the League of Nations, I've added them as playable. One thing you need to know about them, never click on the Senate tab in the game, it will crash. As long as you don't click on the Senate tab, it's next to diplomacy and economy, I believe. So we have diplomacy in the middle, and then we have the Senate to the left, and never click there, it will crash. It's on the same spot where the Pope is in Medieval 2. Okay, so you can play as the League of Nations now, and all the minor factions now have planes and tanks based on history, because it was unfair otherwise. They are not even with the great powers. They have far too few regions and far too few armies, but now at least they have every type of unit. Their tanks might not be as advanced as the great power tanks, but they have tanks, and their planes are actually good. They just don't have the same numbers. Okay, we have the Spanish state. They have three areas in mainland Spain. They have one area in Africa, in North Africa, and then they also start with Chile in South America, because Chile had a similar diplomatic stance as Spain, and they are Spanish speaking, and we had no more room for any additional factions, so I thought instead of letting the League of Nations control Mexico, Colombia, Brazil, Argentina, and Chile, all of the areas in South America with regions, instead of letting the League of Nations control all of it, I added Chile to Spain, to the Spanish state. So they act like an independent nation there. They are neutral to the others. They are not at war. Okay, they are allied in the campaign to the Germans and the Italians, because I didn't want them to be attacked in Europe. But they are intended as a neutral faction, and the fact they're allied makes them less likely to go to war with each other. On very hard, they will still fight each other at one point or another. I'm not sure about easy. Should be less common. Okay, but they are allied to them, but they are not at war with anyone at the start. So unlike Italy and Germany, for example, they are not at war with Soviet or anyone else. They are just allied on paper. And that's still... they still had, like... they supported the Reich with weapons and gear and stuff. And they exported a lot of stuff to the Reich and to Italy. And then they also sent an entire division to Germany to fight the Soviets. But the reason they are allied in the campaign is because I didn't want them to fight each other. But Chile still acts like a neutral faction in South America against the League of Nations and the United States of America and Britain. Well, they border the League of Nations and are not too far away from the United States. However, Britain is far away, they are up in Canada. Okay, we have Turkey. They also have planes now and tanks. So they are stronger. They start with the same areas in Turkey as before, but they have better troops. Okay, we have... and they are neutral, but in history they trained their pilots in Great Britain during the war. Some of them even flew missions over Germany. So they are neutral, but likely to join the Allies. And they also had support from the United States in the form of planes and such. So they got some stuff from the US as well. So they have good relations with the United States and Britain, and they actually had spies looking out on the Italians and the Germans. So they were actually worried that the Germans and the Italians would attack, and that's not too surprising, seeing as this area was part of the Roman Empire in the past, and Italy wanted to restore Rome, so it's likely they would have wanted this area. Anyway, the Japanese Empire, they have no new units. They have one new region on the map. I believe I gave them Hollandia or Papua New Guinea. Okay, and the reason I gave them that area from the start is because they would never go there. And in history, that area was taken over by Japan, and then they fought the British, Australians, and I believe they fought the Australians, but they were fighting under the banner of the British Empire. So the Japanese fought the Australians and the Americans in on that ire, and I believe Britain is holding Port Moresby, and then we have an ire next to it held by America. So now they will fight on that ire instead of before, unlike before, where they never go went there. Okay, we have India. They have both planes and tanks, even though they get their planes in the late game. They have no planes in the beginning, I believe, but they will get them in the late game. Okay, so they have some British Spitfires and Boeing 17 bombers, I believe. They got the British planes, they have the same planes as Britain, but they get them in the late game while Britain has them from the start. Okay, they have the same areas as in the previous version. We have the Soviet Union. So, their armies won't all move at start. I've re-implemented a script forcing most of their standing armies to just stand at their starting locations. This will prevent them from steamrolling Germany, and it will prevent them from taking Romania, Hungary and Bulgaria immediately, and crushing Germany in like 1942. By doing this, Germany will also focus on killing off all their troops, so they will be focused in the east with their troops and thereby have their western areas undefended, which allows for Italy and Spain to, and Vichy France to possibly take back areas there, as there won't be any western invasion, also known as the Normandy invasion. We haven't implemented any scripts for that invasion in this game. So instead, it's likely that Spain, Italy, or Vichy France will attack Eastern Germany. Okay, or Portugal. But Portugal is usually conquered by Spain. Okay, so the Soviet Union has a static defense army now, made up of many armies, but They have a wall of static armies, like in the past, like in the official version, and do not move like in my previous version, because they became too powerful. However, Germany would always win, even when they moved, if they were played by the AI, not if the player played as Germany, because in real time the Soviets were too strong, but in out-resolve, Germany would win. Okay, so I've also increased the troop numbers of Soviet, so they have more troops at start. I believe I added the planes and anti-aircraft batteries to the Soviet starting armies, so they are stronger now and won't be steamrolled by Germany either. It will be a stalemate for a long time, then one of them will get the upper hand. Okay, and because they are so focused on each other, the other smaller factions will be able to live and expand on their own and won't have to bother with neither of those two great powers. Okay, and I believe I also gave them some Boeing 17 American heavy bombers, because in history they had they got some American bomber planes through the Lend-Lease program. They had no models for bombers in this game, so I gave them some American bombers in the late game. Okay, I wanted everyone to have bombers and everyone to have fighters, but with one exception. I believe that the People's Republic of China, the communists in China, which are a very weak faction in this game, starting with one area and two armies, they do not have any bomber planes, but they got a fighter plane now. They got the same Yak 9 plane as the Soviet Union. Okay, so we have Soviet, which has been improved, and then we have the Chinese Republic, starting with most of China. It's the Kuomintang faction led by Chiang Kai-shek, also known as the Chinese nationalists before the war, that were actually friendly with Germany, allied with Germany for a while, but then when the war started and Japan attacked, the relations broke down between Germany and the nationalists, and instead the nationalists allied with the United States became, I believe they are named the Chinese Republic, so they are a republic like the United States, but there are many nationalists in the republic. Okay, so they had good relations with Germany, that's why they have German helmets and such, because they imported some stuff from Germany prior to the war. Okay, but they are allied to the Allies in the war during World War II, and they hold most of China. They are the people in control of Taiwan today. But they were in control of China during World War II and a few years after. Okay, we have the People's Republic of China, communists led by Mao Zedong. They start with this area. And they have two armies at start. I've maxed them out. Even with the two armies, they are kind of underpowered because they are surrounded by enemies. Even if they have some allies from the start, maybe. I think Soviet Union might be an ally. I'm not sure. But anyway, they are likely to be attacked from all sides. By the Republic of China, by Japan, by Soviet, by Britain. So they are not likely to survive for long. But I've seen them do quite well in some campaigns. They managed to take three areas in one campaign and such. But they are attacked from all sides, that's why they usually won't survive. But these guys are the people in charge of China today. The communists, they won the civil war after World War II. During World War II they were allied with the Soviet Union and with the Republic of China. I believe they fought the Republic in a civil war before World War II, but then ceased hostilities when Japan invaded and allied with their former enemy during World War II. And then after World War II they got help from Soviet to defeat the Republic. But they were in a temporary alliance during World War II. Okay. So they have better troops now, but are still weak. We have the French state Vichy, the nation that emerged in France after the defeat. They are holding Lyon, their capital. And they are holding Marseille. Okay, and they also have some new troops. They have the best French tank added to them. They have pack 40 German artillery instead of having the British artillery used by the Free French. Made sense for them to have German artillery instead because they are more like, they are not allied to Germany, but they are like kind of in a relationship with Germany. They are a vassal of Germany, a protectorate if you will. So it makes sense that they would have access to some pack 40s rather than British AMX whatever, AMX 16 or whatever artillery. And then they have some U-88 multi-twin engine fighters and bombers. They are both fighters and bombers. Instead of having the Boeing B-17 bomber, they got the U-88 from Germany. So the Free French have the Boeing instead, the one from Britain and America. Okay, we have Germany. They have the same areas as before. But they have a new artillery unit. They have the Ferdinand from 2.0. And also, I believe that Navier, by the way, I did a mistake and I played the German campaign in 2020. So there were five barracks, I believe, and I placed all the good stuff for all the factions. All the final units of the artillery, the tanks and the planes were placed. No, not the planes. I believe all the three... let's see here. There's an airstrip, an air dome, and an airport. And all of them were in the game, so I could get the best planes with Germany. Everyone else could get their best planes as well, but when it came to the artillery, the infantry, and the tanks, there were five structures, but only four of them were custom. So the fifth one had been edited out. It wasn't in use. And I placed all the best tanks, the best infantry units, and the best artillery units there. So they weren't in the campaign. I couldn't get the Tiger II. I couldn't get the IS-2 Soviet best tank either, etc, etc. So in this version I've added everything to the 4th level that we are in the 5th level previously. So we can have all the tanks, all the infantry and all the artillery now, unlike in that version. Okay, so Germany has access to all the units now, just as everyone else. and they have a new Ferdinand artillery unit, as I said, and I've also given them Argentina in South America. More on that later. Okay, then we have Bulgaria, an Axis power, a minor power. So they allied with Germany and Italy, and they helped in the invasion of Yugoslavia, and they also helped in the invasion of Greece, where they got some areas. But they didn't join the invasion on the Soviet Union, and later they would betray Germany and ally with the Soviet Union. Okay, we have the Thailand faction. As I said in the previous Let's Play, they were forced into an alliance with Japan. It was either joining Japan or being occupied by them. They chose the first one. Okay, but they are, I believe, the same as in the past. They have some Japanese planes and tanks and some infantry. But yeah, they are, I believe they do better now, because I've also changed the action points of the game. So action points, that's the movement points. So I've maxed out the action points, so armies can now move much further each turn. Made sense for 1942 that they would be able to travel vast distances each turn. Remember that one turn is half a month in gameplay time. So if you play for half a month, of course you will be able to travel pretty vast in half a month during 1942. So that's why all the captains can move maximum distances in this game. I reached the hard-coded limit at 304 or 307 action points, something like that. So now they can move way further. Previously, if you stood here, you could probably move here in one turn. Now you can probably move all the way over here. So it's a big improvement. Okay, we have the Italian Empire. As you know, Mussolini, Benito Mussolini, leader of Italy, or the leader of the Italian Empire. He wanted a new Roman Empire, so that's his war goal. In this game, he has now, I believe in this version, he has gotten a new bomber. I believe he has access to Stuka bombers. He had them in history. So I added some Stukas to the faction. Otherwise, he has the same units as before and the same regions. Now he has Stuka bombers as well, not just fighters. Okay, we have Hungary, another minor faction, very loyal to Germany. They didn't change side. They fought to the end, and were occupied by Soviet in the end. So they didn't betray Hitler, unlike the others. And they were once part of the Austro-Hungarian Empire. So yeah, they had a relationship with Austria in the past. In World War I, they were part of the same empire as Austria. And now they are an ally of Germany, and Germany includes Austria, so... Okay, and they fought to the end, just like the Germans did, until their capital fell and was taken by the Soviets. Okay, they have some unique tanks and such, just like before. I don't think they have anything new, no. Finland, I believe I gave them a U-88 twin-engine multiple role aircraft. I believe they are both bombers and fighters, and they got such a plane because they had them in history and they needed a bomber. They didn't have a bomber plane. Okay, so they have one new type of plane. I also made their army an elite army. So it's at level 9 in each area. They have level 9 in experience, level 9 in they have level 9 in experience and level 3 in armor and level 3 in weapon. So they have the golden level. They are armor upgraded to the max and weapon upgraded to the max. So they have an elite army. It will increase the chances in auto-resolve against superior numbers, just like in history where one Finnish army could defeat several Soviet forces. Okay, but they still were forced to give up in the end because they didn't have the numbers to continue to fight. Soviet could just keep sending troops there. Also, if Soviet had sent their entire army towards Finland, Finland would have lost. But they still sent most of their troops against Germany, but the troops they sent against Finland were still superior in all areas, in the sense they had numerical advantage and ammunition advantage and mechanized advantage and so forth. Even they had also air superiority, like one plane of Finland were forced to fight like 60 Soviet planes or something, but still Finland managed to hold their border, which was very impressive. Okay, so Finland has been improved, they have one new plane and they have an elite army from the start. Okay, and then but they won't do much better in battle, only a little bit, because experience doesn't really matter when they use weapons that you know are fired. They still die just as easily by the projectiles of the tanks or the planes and even the gunners, but at least in out-result they do better now. Okay, Romania, another Axis power. I believe they were allied to Germany and helped in the invasion of the Soviet Union together with Italy and Hungary. But when Marshal Antonescu were, I believe, replaced by a new leader and they changed government in 1943, then they switched sides and attacked Germany and joined the Soviet Union. But as long as Marshal Antonescu, a fascist, was in charge, they were on the Nazi side. Okay, they do not have anything new, I believe. Then we have Portugal. They have a bunch of new stuff. They have, I believe in my previous version, I believe in the official version, they have no tanks. In my old version from 2020, I added Fiat 3000 Italian tanks to them. And then in this version I've added two more tanks. I've added the Stuart from America, the light tank, and the M4 Sherman, a medium American tank, because they had those tanks in history. I'm not sure if they had the Fire 3000, but I saw that Brazil had that tank in all documentaries, and I've made Brazil Portugal. So Chile is Spain, and Brazil is Portugal. Well, Mexico and Colombia is the League of Nations. We have the League of Nations in an alliance, because the history is that the League of Nations is an organization set up by the Americans, and Mexico and Colombia, bordering Panama, they joined with America in the war against the Axis powers. So they joined World War II on the side of the Allies, and were a part of the League of Nations. But and we are armed and such by America, but the Chilean state, they didn't join. They had friendly relations with the Axis powers. They have the same helmets as Germany, so they look like German soldiers in a way. They were probably dictatorship. They were fascist, but they also had friendly relations with America. Because they traded with America, they also traded with the Reich, but during the war, Germany and Italy were blockaded by the Allies, so they were forced to trade more with the Allies than with the Axis, because the Axis couldn't reach them, because the Allies controlled the sea. So the Chileans, they had friendly relations with Germany up until 1942. When Germany invaded the Soviet Union, it was highly unpopular in Chile, because the Chileans, the majority of the people there, sympathized with the communists, actually. The workers of Chile actually had sympathies for the Soviet cause, for the communist cause, so I might be wrong that they were fascists, but they had tendencies, their state had tendencies from the Axis powers, but the people there lean towards communism, and they had friendly relations and trade relations with America and such. So during the war they were pretty much forced to trade with America more than with Germany, and when Germany invaded Soviet, it was highly unpopular among their populace, and then Japan attacked America, and from that point on the Chilean state broke relations with Axis, and this mode starts in 1942 at about the same time when Chile broke relations with Germany and Japan and Italy. So they are neutral, they are represented by the Spanish state as such, another neutral faction with previous sympathies for the Axis. Okay, and then we have let's see here, we're on Portugal. So Portugal, Brazil. So Brazil and Argentina, we are about to fight each other. A war was almost about to break out between Brazil and Argentina during the 40s, and for Brazil to join America, they demanded that America would support them in a possible war against Argentina. So Argentina was very fascist back then. They had similar politics as in Germany. They actually had they were sympathizers of Germany, and let's just say they were fascist and they were sympathizing with Germany during the war, and they were almost about to fight a war with Brazil, and Brazil demanded that the United States would support them against Argentina in a possible war for them to join the United States and the Allies against the Axis powers. So, and the United States were reluctant to accept this demand, so that's why they didn't join the Allies until 1943, when finally the United States accepted those demands. But in 1942 Brazil was still neutral, so they are represented by Portugal. So we have Chile, represented by the Spanish state, the Spanish-speaking people, and are represented by the Spanish state, and the Portuguese-speaking people, Brazil, represented by Portugal. And then we have Mexico and Colombia, represented by the League of Nations, the two factions that have joined the Allies. And then we have Argentina, represented by the Third Reich, because the story is that they were neutral, but they sympathized with Germany, and in 1945, 1 month before Hitler committed suicide, the Argentine faction declared war on Hitler and the Germans. They only declared war 1 month before Hitler killed himself. So in other words, they joined the war in the final moments of the war just to look good. So it doesn't really matter. And in 1944 they broke down relations. But in 1944, in real history, Germany and Italy had already lost. The invasion in Normandy, the D-Day, or Doomsday, it happened in the summer of 1944, so the war was still lost in 1944, and the Argentine state knew that Hitler had lost. That's why they broke down relations with them, because they had to think about the future and good relations with the United States and such, trade relations and such. But let's say in this game, if Germany isn't defeated, is defeating the Soviet Union and such, what is to say the Argentine faction wouldn't have allied Germany? I think they would. I think if Germany if Germany had won the war against Soviet and Britain, then yes, the Argentine faction would have certainly allied Germany, and because they had the same politics pretty much. It's just that Germany lost, and also, the Germans, after the war, they fled to Argentina and helped build up their army. They even gave them German jets in the 50s, so that's why I've given Argentina to Germany, Chile to Spain, and Portugal to Brazil. So we have three new factions there bordering the League of Nations. All of them are neutral except Germany, of course, but Germany represents Argentina, the aggressor state in that area. Then we have two neutral factions. One of them, which is about to join America. So, sure, Spain and Portugal didn't hold those areas during World War II, but as we can't have any more factions, we have 21 factions already, we had to use placeholders. So I could have used rebels, or I could just give them to Spain and Portugal, and I thought Spain and Portugal was better. Was the better options. Okay. So, South America is different, and I've added, as I said, M4 Shermans and Stuarts to Portugal. Yeah, so they have better tank, they have a better light tank, and they have a new medium tank. And compared to the official version, they have 3 tanks instead of 0 tanks. So, yeah. Okay, so we will play on easy difficulty. And no battle time limit, and manage all settlements, medium difficulty in battle. And I was gonna play as the United States of America, actually. By the way, I forgot one thing. So we saw that French Republic, we can check them again. So British Commonwealth of Nations, easy. United States of America, very easy. French Republic, hard. League of Nations, medium difficulty. Spanish state, hard. Turkey, hard. Japanese Empire, very easy. India, medium. United Soviet Socialist Republics, the Soviet Union, very easy. Chinese Republic, or the Kuomintang, easy. People's Republic of China, or modern day China, Communist China, very hard. French state Vichy, medium. German Reich, or the Third Reich, medium difficulty. Bulgaria, very hard. Thailand, hard. Italian Empire, or Italy, hard. Medium, actually. Hungary, hard. Finland, hard. Romania, very hard. And Portugal, very hard. I will play with the United States of America. So, origins. So I could actually take some time reading. This will probably be pretty long. Origins. United States of America, okay, 1942. Difficulty factor, very easy. Origins. American public opinion was hostile to Hitler's Germany, but how much aid to give the Allies was controversial. Public opinion was even more hostile to Japan, and there was little opposition to increased support for China. By 1940, the United States, while still neutral, was becoming the arsenal of democracy for the Allies, supplying money and war materials. The sudden defeat of France in spring 1940s caused the nation to begin to greatly grow its armed forces, including the first peacetime draft. After the German invasion of the Soviet Union in June 1941, America began sending lend-lease aid to the Soviet Union, as well as Britain and China. Yeah, so the Americans did intervene in Japan's war in China and in Germany's war in Soviet by giving them lots of trucks and oil and weapons and even planes and such. I mean, sure, America didn't declare war on Germany. They didn't declare a war on Japan. It was Japan that first struck Pearl Harbor, and Germany followed suit by declaring war on America. But America did help China and Soviet before they declared any war against America. So, in essence, they were making it more difficult for Germany and Japan to win their wars. So they felt forced to declare war on the United States, and I believe it was inevitable. And yeah, if you aid an enemy of Germany, then of course Germany will see that as a hostile action, same with Japan. So that's probably why they invaded. But they didn't really invade the American mainland. They only struck at the fleet at Pearl Harbor because they wanted to put it out of action. Because America had sent an ultimatum to Japan before the attack, where they said that they would use their fleet against Japan if Japan didn't accept an unconditional withdrawal to Japan. And as you know, with Japan, withdrawal wasn't an option. So instead of withdrawing from China, they decided to attack the fleet at Pearl Harbor in a preemptive strike and take it out of the war. Their gamble was that they would get enough time by doing this to defeat China before America could build up their fleet again, but they were wrong because the American industry was more effective than Japan had suspected. Okay, so American volunteers. Prior to America's entry into World War II in December 1941, individual Americans volunteered to fight against Axis powers in other nations' armed forces, although under American law it was illegal for United States citizens to join the armed forces of foreign nations, and in doing so, they lost their citizenship. Many American volunteers changed their nationality to Canadian. However, Congress passed a blanket pardon in 1944. American mercenary Colonel Charles Sweeney, living in London, began recruiting American citizens to fight as a U.S. volunteer detachment in the French Air Force. However, France fell before this was implemented. During the Battle of Britain, 11 American pilots flew in the RAF, Royal Air Force, one of whom was killed. Charles Sweeney's nephew, also called Charles, formed a home guard unit from American volunteers living in London. One notable example was the Eagle Squadrons, these being Royal Air Force squadrons made up of American volunteers and British personnel. Another notable example was the Flying Tigers, created by Claire L. Chennault, a retired U.S. Army Air Corps officer working in the China since August 1937, first as military aviation advisor to the Generalissimo Chiang Kai-shek in the early months of the Sino-Japanese War. Generalissimo Chiang Kai-shek is leader of Kuomintang, or the Republic of China, the main Chinese faction in the game. Okay, see, he ruled China during World War II. Okay, one notable example was the, let's see here. Lend-Lease and Iceland occupation. The year 1940 marked a change in attitude in the United States. German victories in France, Poland, and elsewhere, combined with the Battle of Britain, led many Americans to believe that the United States would be forced to fight soon. In March 1941, the Lend-Lease program began shipping money, munitions, and food to Britain, China, and by that fall, the Soviet Union. By 1941, the United States was taking an active part in the war, despite its nominal neutrality. In spring, U-boats began their wolf pack tactics, which threatened to sever the transatlantic supply line. Oops, that wasn't intended. Line. Roosevelt extended the Pan-American security zone east almost as far as Iceland. Yes, they conquered Iceland to prevent Germans from taking it first, because Iceland could be used as a base to launch attacks on America, I believe. The US Navy's neutrality patrols were anything but, as in practice, their function was to report Axis ship and submarine sightings to the British and Canadian navies. From April, the US Navy began escorting Allied convoys from Canada as far as the Mid-Atlantic meeting point south of Iceland, where they handed off to the Royal Navy. Okay. On 16 June 1941, after negotiation with Churchill, Roosevelt ordered the United States occupation of Iceland to replace the British invasion forces. On 22nd June 1941, the US Navy sent Task Force 19, TF-19, from Charleston, South Carolina, to assemble at Argentina, Newfoundland. TF-19 included 25 warships and the first provisional Marine Brigade, 194 officers and 3,714 men from San Diego, California, under the command of Brigadier General John Marston. Task Force 19, TF-19, sailed from Argentina on 1st July, on 7th July. Okay, Britain persuaded Althing in Iceland to approve an American occupation force under a US-Icelandic defense agreement, and TF-19 anchored off Reykjavik that evening. US Marines commenced landing on 8 July and disembarkation was completed on 12th July. On 6th August, the US Navy established an air base at Reykjavik with the arrival of Patrol Squadron VP-73 PBE Catalinas and VP-74 PBM Mariners. US Army personnel began arriving in Iceland in August, and the Marines had been transferred to the Pacific by March 1942. Up to 40,000 US military personnel were stationed on the island, numbering adult Icelandic men. At the time, Iceland had a population of about 120,000 in total. The agreement was for the US military to remain until the end of the war. American warships escorting Allied convoys in the Eastern Atlantic had several hostile encounters with U-boats. On 4 September, a German U-boat attacked the destroyer USS Greer of Iceland. A week later, Roosevelt ordered American warships to attack U-boats on sight. A U-boat shot up the USS Kearney as it escorted a British merchant convoy. The USS Reuben James was sunk by U-552 on 31st October 1941. The attack on Pearl Harbor. Because of Japanese advances in French Indochina and China, the United States, in coordination with the British and Dutch, cut off all oil supplies to Japan, which had imported 90% of its oil. Oil embargo threatened to grind the Japanese military machine to a halt. Japan refused American demands to leave China and decided that war with the United States was inevitable. His only hope was to strike first. President Roosevelt had months earlier transferred the American fleet to Hawaii from California in order to deter the Japanese. Admiral Isoroku Yamamoto agreed that the only way to win the war was to knock out the powerful main American fleet immediately. His fleet approached within 200 miles of Hawaii without being detected. Admiral Shuichi Nagumo held tactical command. Over a five-hour period, his six carriers sent two waves of 360 dive bombers, torpedo planes, and fighters. They destroyed or severely damaged 8 battleships, 10 smaller warships, and 230 aircraft. 2,403 American servicemen and civilians were killed. Japanese losses were negligible. 29 planes shot down. Several American planes were also shot down by anti-aircraft fire. So they shot down their own planes in the chaos. Commander Minoru excuse me, Commander Minoragenda, the chief planner of the raid, begged Nagumo to strike again at the shore facilities, oil storage tanks, and submarines, and to hunt down the American carriers that were supposedly nearby. Yeah, they should have done that. It would have been a good idea for Japan. Okay. But Nagumo decided not to risk further action. To reach Pearl Harbor, they had to learn how to refuel at sea, a technique the US Navy already had worked out. To sink all those ships, they used their electric torpedoes and shallow water bombing tactics. Despite later rumors, there was no advanced knowledge of the Japanese plan. The commanders had been complacent about routine defensive measures. In broader perspective, the attack was a failure. The lost battleships reflected obsolete doctrine and were not needed. The lost planes were soon replaced. The casualty list was short by World War II standards. Yeah, I believe 2,000 Americans killed in a firebombing, maybe 200,000 Japanese were killed, so yeah, 2,000 were nothing in terms of World War II death counts. Okay, they died way more Americans in battles against Germans in Normandy. I believe they lost about 40,000 there, something. So that's way more than 2,000. Okay, let's see here. Tokyo's calculation that the Americans would lose heart and seek a compromise peace proved widely wrong. The sneak attack electrified public opinion, committing America with near unanimity to a war to the death against the Japanese Empire. Following the attack on Pearl Harbor, President Roosevelt officially pronounced 7th December 1941 as a date which will live in infamy, and asked for a declaration of war on Japan before joint session of Congress on 8th December 1941. The notion passed with only one vote against it in both chambers. Just 3 days later, on 11th December 1941, Adolf Hitler declared war on the United States and had already remarked on the evening of the date of the Japanese attack that we can't lose the war at all. We now have an ally which has never been conquered in 3,000 years. Fall of the Philippines and Dutch East Indies. Within hours of Pearl Harbor, Japanese air forces from Formosa destroyed much of the US Far East Air Force based near Manila. The Japanese army invaded and trapped the American and Filipino forces on the Bataan Peninsula. Roosevelt evacuated General Douglas MacArthur and the nurses, but there was no way to save the trapped men against overwhelming Japanese naval power. MacArthur flew to Australia, vowing, "I came out of Bataan and I shall return." Major General Jonathan M. Wainwright surrendered on 8 May. The prisoners died by the thousands in the Bataan Death March and in disease-ridden Japanese prison camps where food and medicine were in very short supply. The Japanese Navy seemed unstoppable as they seized the Dutch East Indies to gain its rich oil resources. The American, British, Dutch and Australian forces were combined under the ABDA command, but its fleet was quickly sunk in several naval battles around Java. And that is where the campaign starts. So our fleet has been sunk, and the combined navies of Britain, America and the Dutch have been sunk. However, Britain has more fleets than that. But in other words, the Dutch has been defeated and occupied by the Japanese, and the Americans have lost their fleet, and Britain is the only naval power strong enough to fight them. Okay, and let's start the campaign. So I am not the best English speaker, and it's been a while since I last made a video. That's why I was kind of mediocre reading all this. But anyway, I'm a Swedish guy. You will have to bear with me. Okay, let's start the campaign now. and try to play with the current unit numbers. Oh, there's an intro video. Not all of the factions have it. Yavin has two, and Soviet probably. But I don't think Britain has one for the minor factions. I think only Yavin and the United States, maybe Soviet. America. Okay. So we will fight a very aggressive campaign in all areas of the war. We'll build up our troops in America and we will attack the Japanese and the Germans. So in history, the United States used to focus on the Germans first. We already have troops in Africa, so we will fight there and we will also defend the areas close to Thailand, I believe, close to Singapore, where we have some bases, but we have no good troops there. We might actually lose them.